open ends. What about them, eh? Oh. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 1981 TV Week Rock Music Awards. This is the second time the awards have been covered by Countdown. The awards presented on tonight's show are for achievements in 1980, and what an amazing year it was for Australian music. Established groups like Split Enz and Cold Chisel released two of the finest albums ever produced in Australia. Relatively new groups like Australian Crawl and Flowers arrived on the scene with excellent debut albums, and as the year progressed, more and more talent emerged. The Numbers, James Freud, In Excess, The Dugites and Midnight Oil are just a few who have not only created excitement in this country, but also prompted immense interest internationally. Major Australian rock names, The Angels and LRB, furthered their careers overseas. But without a doubt, the most spectacular international success of 1980 was our own Air Supply, who had some They had a sensational impact on the American charts with three top five singles off one album. And to top it all off, they achieved the number one position on the US Top 100 with their second American single, All Out of Love. That's a remarkable effort. Well, performing on tonight's show, we are proud to have what we consider some of the finest talents in the world. We've already seen Split Enz, but later in the show, we'll see the Flowers, the Swingers, Air Supply, Australian Crawl, and Cold Chisel. Woo! Tonight, we'll at last find out the award winners for 1980. And boy, has there been some speculation this year. But might I add that in my mind, and the minds of a lot of other people, there are no losers. Absolutely no losers. The Australian music industry is at last something we can be very, very proud of. It's matured, and I think all Australian groups and artists deserve an ovation. And now to the awards themselves. Like last year, the public and the industry were invited to vote. The public voted through coupons in TV Week late 1980. The industry was made up of urban and regional AM and FM radio stations, plus major musical journalists throughout Australia. The votes were sent directly to and counted by Pricewaterhouse Company of Chartered Accountants. The same company, I might add, tabulates the votes for the Academy Award. No one associated with TV Week or Countdown was allowed to vote, and no one, and I mean but no one, apart from Pricewaterhouse, knows at this moment who has won. The results are all in sealed envelopes with the man from Pricewaterhouse over there, and all in all, I think it's going to be a very exciting night. Now that I've blundered my way through that, it's time to get down to the business. To use an old quote from Shakespeare, the quote is from Bugs Bunny. Let's get on with the show. To present the most popular female award, we have a very, very special lady. In the early 70s, this tiny figure burst onto the world rock scene, dressed in black leather, whipping her guitar, and growling out some hot rock and roll. Australian audiences loved her, and she loved them back. As my friend Martha Davis from the Motels put it, this lady's been around the block and back again. And I'm very proud to say she is back again. Would you put your hands together for Miss Suzy Quatro? Actually, welcome to the show. I don't dare kiss you after what I did to Olivia Newton-John last year.
What did you do?
Well, it nearly ruined my image, actually.
I'm not saying a word.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
You must be very happy. Already this year, one hit in Australia.
Yes, fantastic.
Yeah, rock hard. But the big question is, you're out here to do the TV Week Rock Awards. When are you going to tour again?
Oh, it's been so long. Australia's the best. July, August.
And I've got to ask you this, are you going to do any old numbers, like the old ones?
Oh, you got to. We do a couple from each album.
Yeah?
I mean, I couldn't do a show without doing Double Gay Drive. I just couldn't do
you
it.
You certainly couldn't. And listen, when was the first time you toured?
74. Twice in 74.
That was memorable, actually.
That was good.
Yeah. Remember the Melbourne reception?
Oh, they had the
bikies.
The bikies, and then the TV people come up to interview me, and Guitar Zan come up and burped in the microphone.
Oh, hello, Guitar
Zan. It was great. Yeah. Yes. It was really good.
Right.
Bit of realism on television.
Now listen, it's very apt that you actually present this award, because in one way you're one of the pioneers of rock and roll for female singers, right? Taking on the groups. Do you like her? Oh. And like tonight, unlike sort of years gone past, females found it very hard. Did you find it hard when you first, like all those fellas? You married one of them.
Well, I don't mind fellas being hard.
Right. Oh, fair enough, Susie. No, please, Paul need a nutter. Anyway, listen, let's get on with it. It doesn't only deal with solo artists, it deals with female lead singers of groups. So let's have a look at the nominations. We're looking at the nominations.
The first nomination for tonight is Christy Allen. And Christy is the only female nominee for the awards who had a national top three hit in 1980. When Annalise Morrow delivers her brother Chris Morrow's songs, it's been said that she brings Australian female vocals into the 80s. Linda Nutter sings for one of the only bands in Australia who know how to smile. And with a top 10 debut album, No Wonder. With the Dugites, Linda Nutter.
Okay. Well, I know.
Well, there's some talent. Susie,
okay.
You've got the envelope.
Now I get to open this up.
Gosh, Pricewaterhouse has got very official envelopes.
All right. Most popular Australian female performer 1980, Christy Allen. Well, I'd just like to thank my record company, and a special thanks to Phil from the CAAS, and well, thanks everybody. Thank you.
Listen, just before you go, as we've all read, Christy was very sick and had to go back to Perth where her parents live, and I tell you what, it's great to see you back.
It's
it really
to be
is.
Back. Thank you. Thanks.
Well, now it's time to look at the most popular male vocal. Who do you think it is? They're a wild audience.
Yeah, right.
All right, listen, the male vocalist, again like the female vocalist, it's been now, instead of solo acts, it's sort of like, it can be a sort of a singer from a lead group, from a, you know, a group or anything like that. So, I think we better get on with it, all
I
right?
I think we better, yes.
Let's now have a look at the nominees for the most popular male vocal.
John English had a quiet year in 1980. However, he did make it to the top 10 with this song.
I'll know.
Jimmy Barnes fronts one of the most popular live bands in Australia, Cold Chisel. James Raine with Australian Crawl worked hard in 1980 to create high national demand for the band, both live and on record.
Sure is. Okay, open the envelope.
I'm dying to find out myself. Right. How do you pronounce it?
The winner.
The most popular Australia May performer for 1980 is James
Raine. Thanks to the band. Thanks very much.
The title track from their first album, Ice House, Flowers.
Thank you. What an incredible young group they are. The Flowers with Ice House. And incidentally, after all those outrageous predictions I made last year, if any of the rock journalists or programmers would like to throw the cream pies now, you've got 2 seconds. One, two, forget it, all right? And now, I beg your pardon, programmers and journalists, I said. And now to announce the most popular DJs from around Australia, I'd like to introduce you to a former jockey, a former disc jockey, a very successful punter, and a very successful television compere. From Sounds, here's Donnie. Different.
Thank you very much. Ian and I and a few other people work on television in the music industry, and I guess it's been beneficial, it's been of help to the music industry, but we also have radio that helps the music industry in a big way. In fact, for years the Australian jocks have been behind the Australian product, and I thank them for that. What about a round of applause for all the jocks? And that's why I'm on this show, which is rather strange. Yeah, it's lovely. Thank you, darling. How are you? Say hello to your mum. The best disc jockeys from each state is why I'm here to do my little bit, and I will nominate them and name them, and already they have received their awards. So you'll just see them pop up. Give them a big round of applause when they do so here in the theatre. Any disc jockeys here ever get nervous on television? I get a touch of the nerves. You wouldn't believe it. From 6 p.m. in Perth, our first winner comes, and he is, and I would like you to please give him a big round of applause, Gary Shannon. I saw him walk across the street into the theatre and he trod on something again. He's our next winner, and he's from Brisbane, 4BK. He handles breakfast on 4BK, and it is Wayne E. Poo, Wayne Roberts. The next winner is from Adelaide, 5AD, and the winner for South Australia is Steve Curtis. This next fella won the award for Hobart for this year, for 1980, but he's not there anymore. He's working on 4BC in Brisbane, and he's staying at my place tonight, and he's a good fella. None of that, he's just, you know, staying over for the night. We'll have plenty to drink, though. Tim Franklin from last year, 7HT, please. Tim Franklin. And this next guy has won more awards than you can poke a stick at. Greg Evans from 3XY in Melbourne. And finally, our own state, New South Wales, from Sydney 2SM, Ian McRae. Catch us if you can.
Okay, congratulations to all the DJs. And Donnie, I know you're nervous, and that's worrying about Hobart. Well, mate, I'm out. Anyway, listen, take a bow. Come on, Donnie's coming. All right, we have a very special guest to present the most popular group award. I first met this particular gentleman about 10 years ago, when you're still a teenager and singing in one of the most successful groups in the world. Last January, I met up with him again, and during an interview, he said that he'd like to come down to Australia anytime we'd like to ask him. Well, we asked him, and he's here. Like his brothers, he at 26 is a veteran. The group I was referring to, of course, is the Jackson Five. And now, here is the former lead singer of the Jackson Five. These days, he's an artist and record producer in his own right. Let's give a big welcome to Mr. Jermaine Jackson. Listen, he may be a great singer, he is a shocking horse rider. And he's a liar too. He said, I fell off three times. He was the one that fell off three times. No joking, only joking. Listen, I've got to ask you first off, and you've been saying it, you said it on Countdown, you said it on Sounds, and you've said it on the Mike Walsh and Don Lane, but are you really going to come back?
Of course we are.
The Jacksons?
Yeah, yeah.
When?
Well, we'll be here, I guess, in the first part of 82, 1982.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Now, listen, on top of that, being in a group and you were so young, I mean, did you ever dream at that stage? I mean, I know everyone has wild dreams when they're young, but I mean, like, did you ever dream that you'd be this successful, the group first off, and then individually?
Well, I never thought that we would come this far, but I guess we put a lot of hard work into it, so it pays off.
All right. Listen, one thing I've got to ask you, for a lot of people out there, because we know you've got a brother, how's Michael?
Michael's great. He's doing fine.
Actually, you spoke to him the other night, didn't you?
Yeah, he told me to tell everybody hi, and he's going to be excited about coming over.
All right, you're doing the Most Popular Group Award, and being in a group, I mean, it must be pretty hard.
Kind of, yeah.
It's even harder becoming the most popular one. Let's have a look at the nominees.
All right.
All right?
The first impression Australia had of Australian Paul was James Wayne shaking his plastic cast at the cameras on Countdown. Although James is the focal point, the Crawl is very much a band. He's in this fog. I bet he's in. Yeah, yeah. He's in this fog. Many people tell Cole Chisel's enormously increased popularity in 1980 had very much to do with the diversity and strength of their third album, East.
The mind absolutely boggles what happens, you know? I mean, like, that talent, just
well,
open the envelope, Derek.
For the most popular Australian group, 1980, the winner is... Cole Chisel.
Picking up the award for Cole Chisel is Rod Willis.
God. Thank you very, very much. Thank you, from Cole Chisel.
It's getting hotter and hotter. Our next presenter is a total surprise, but he certainly needs no introduction unless you have a very short memory. With his band, he set the Australian charts alight in the late 70s. And then for reasons of his own, he chose to withdraw from the public spotlight. I know I speak for everyone, you out there, everyone, when I say it's great to see him back, because we cannot afford to be without such talent and such charisma. Please welcome to center stage the presenter of the Johnny O'Keefe Memorial Award for Best New Talent, Mr. Mark Hunter.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. What a blissful occasion this is. Good evening. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm presenting the New Talent Award for 1980. This is a very important award. It's a good award. Shh, this is being really serious. Back in about 1978 when Dragon won it, I can remember being pleased that we won it and proud. But most of all, I think we were grateful that someone had taken the time to delineate the difference of degree of effort that was involved. Did you like that sentence? For a short time, it gave us the feeling that there was a reward involved for action, for positive action. This award shows that there is recognition for effort and excellence. Let us now take a look at the nominations for the Best New Talent Award.
The Dewgites have a craftsman for a songwriter, and to further quote Greg Taylor, have no competitors in their style in this country. Their live musicianship leaves you knowing there's a lot more where this came from. Flowers music is music you can listen to and dance to. That was their aim, and they've achieved it. Their music was probably the most scrutinized in 1980, and the answer was an all-round very, very good. In Excess are serious about having a good time, and their personal hard-edged style is very much in demand. They are young, and their first album sold equal to the first albums of Dragon, Angels, and Chisel. Karen Knowles as a nomination exemplifies the need and potential success in Australia for many forms of music. Karen had to compete against some of the best new talent this country has seen. The nomination is quite an achievement.
Of the Johnny O'Keefe Memorial Award for the Best New Talent for 1980, of Flowers.
Picking up the Best New Talent Award for Flowers is their record company managing director, Martin Favini.
Thanks a lot.
With their number one song, here's
into your eyes, don't know.
What a great song, eh? Eh? Oh, it deserves to be number one. The Swingers with Counting the Beat. And it's great to see, I might add, that many New Zealanders are making Australia their home and contributing to the Australian music scene. And as these awards are for Australian music, we had to have a definition of who was eligible. And that is any artist who was resident or had management based in Australia during the calendar year of the awards. Unfortunately, in 1980, that excluded fine New Zealand performers like Sharon O'Neill and Kim Hart from being nominated. But maybe next year we can make it the Australasian Awards. Here's hoping so. Right, at this stage of the proceedings, it's 7 minutes past six. And if you've just tuned into the Rock Awards, you know, didn't figure about the 5:30 bit, then you've just missed Split Enz performing, The Swingers and The Flowers. And if you happen to watch the awards last year, you'll know that we were interrupted by the weather. So in case we break into the weather this time, I'll give you the forecast for today. In Brisbane, it's sunny because Mr. Bjorken Peterson said so. In Sydney, it's a bit stick and very nerve-wracking. In Melbourne, it's politically storming. In Hobart, pick the apples now. In Adelaide, it's absolutely unpredictable. And in Perth, well, Dire Straits are performing tonight, so it's got to be really hot. Oh. If we happen to encroach into the news, the world-shattering headline for today is that good old Prince Charles has finally managed to stay on his horse. Well, all I can say, Charlie, is live and let die. And finally, if we happen to get interrupted by the cricket, then we've all lost the plot, because the ABC doesn't even televise it anymore. That's unless good old Kerry Packer has just bought us over the last 20 minutes. Okay, back to the serious side of the business. We have two presenters for the Best Recorded Songwriter. I spoke about them and their American success earlier, and without a doubt, they are two of the most modest people I know in the industry. Would you make a big welcome to Russell and Graham from Air Supply.
Thanks. Well, as Ian has already told you, thank you, darling. As Ian has already told you, Graham has had a tremendous year last year as a songwriter. And I'm sure that everyone in Air Supply really appreciates these awards because they do recognise the fantastic talent that we have in Australia.
As a songwriter, I know from first hand how difficult it is to achieve success. And these awards show us just how easy it is when we really try to open the door to overseas recognition. So let's go now to the industry nominations for Best Recorded Songwriter.
Ivor Davies has not been writing songs all his life. He only began to write in the last couple of years. However, he used to write stories, and in his songs he still does, most of them quietly frightening. Neil Finn wrote three songs on the Enz album, Missing Person, What's the Matter with You, and I Got You. If you listen, you can hear Neil is mostly interested in melody and clever lines. Tell me you're not easy. Don Walker writes with keen insight. He can write with humour and wit. He can absorb loneliness and desperation. With chisel hard driving the point, he can warn that perhaps something is going wrong.
And the winner is Don Walker.
Picking up the award for Don Walker from Cold Chisel is Rod Willis.
On behalf of Don, thank you very much.
And now, with their three top three songs from the American National Chart, here's a medley from Graham and Russell with Air Supply.
Overnight scenes, dinner and wine, Saturday girls. I was never in love, never had the time in my hustle and hurry world.
Laughing myself to sleep, waking up lonely. I needed someone to hold me, oh.
Well, there they are, Air Supply. Look, I find it very hard to believe, but it's true, that not so many years ago that Russell used to sell suitcases at Barclays.
Oh, dear me.
And would you believe that those three songs that they've just performed have sold over a total of more than 5.5 million records? 5.5 million records? My God, no wonder he left Barclays. And to think he wouldn't even give me 10 cents for a phone call before. Russell, you're a stingy. Anyway, listen. Our next presenter will announce the best single for 1980. And this presenter is a living example of a kid out of school who became a punk rocker. He formed a band, but found it hard to get the overall industry and audience to treat him seriously. The knockbacks that he and his band received will be enough to shatter any teenager's dreams. But with the hope and faith, he, along with a few that believed in him, he persevered with his talents. He spent a year concentrating on his songwriting. He then formed a group and he co-produced his own album. The first single off the album proved to be a smash hit. It was Modern Girl, and I could only be talking about Mr. James Freud.
Hello. Thank you. I had a speech all worked out that I was going to make, but I don't think there's really much you can say about the best single for 1980. There's three groups that have been nominated, and all three of those groups are equally as talented, and there's so many other groups that weren't nominated that would take ages to mention. But it's the hit singles by Australian groups what makes Australian radio what it is. So now, without going on anymore, we'd like to have a look at the nominees for the best single of 1980.
Downhearted was written by the Crawls drummer Bill McDonough, his brother Guy, and a friend of theirs, Sean Higgins. Although Boys Light Up is the showstopper, it's Downhearted that made the top 10 and stayed there nationally for 13 weeks. Mondo Rock released Eric McCusker's State of the Heart. Quite a few people wondered if they knew what they were doing. It wasn't rock, it was Rundgren. And it's just gone gold. That's 50,000 singles. I got you.
Well, here we go. The winners are a group that's worked years for it. Split Enz, I've Got You.
Picking up the award for best single is the writer, Neil Finn.
Hold on. Anyway, thank you everyone, especially all the friends of the end. That's you.
Thank you, James, and thank you, Tim. About 58 people have just died at the ABC at the moment. I mean, like, goodness me, our director, you're still there, Robbie? Yeah, goodness. Whew. Over the past 5 years, the album market in Australia has changed radically. And one of the greatest contributors to this change of direction is a television show which specialises in album cuts. To present the awards for the best record cover design and the best album, I'm proud to introduce the host of Night Moves and the program director of EM FM in Melbourne, the cool Greek god, Mr. Lee Simon.
Thank you, Molly. Thank you. Okay, the first of these two awards is one that was announced prior to the show beginning, and that is for the Best Australian Album Cover. Probably one of the most underestimated parts of the recording game is the album cover. It's important because as a marketing tool, it's vital that it's an exciting cover or an interesting cover so that it stands out amongst all the others within a record store. And just from a straight-out image point of view, it's also important that it doesn't clash with the image of the band or of their music. There were four nominations in the Best Australian Album Cover. They were Australian Crawl's album, The Boys Light Up, Concept and Photography by Graham Webber and Returb Studios in Melbourne. Cold Chisel's East album is another one. Phil Mortlock, Concept, and Greg Noakes, Photographer. Ice House by Flowers was another one. Concept and artwork by their drummer, John Lloyd. And the fourth one was True Colours, Split Ends. Concept and also artwork once again by their drummer, Noel Crombie. And the winner was, for that particular category, Cold Chisel's East. And once again, congratulations to the person who conceived the album, Phil Mortlock, and also the photographer, Greg Noakes. Okay, let's move inside the cover right now to the Best Australian Album for 1980. As Molly said, one of the most exciting areas of growth in Australian music over the past few years has been the growth of the Australian album. It's proportionate to the increase in talent with Australian musicians, and also just straight-out economics dictate that you've got to get value for money these days, and one track won't do. It's also a case of me being very thankful for albums, because it certainly helps programs like mine and also the FM radio stations that have just started around the country. That's the basis that they play all their music on. So right now, with any further ado, let's have a look at the nominations for the Best Australian Album for 1980.
Apart from the expected Don Walker classics with distinctive Barnes vocals, each member of Chisel has contributed to the songwriting on East. And it's the songs by Moss and Presswich that have extended Chisel's music into new areas of the field. You can dance to tracks from Ice House and enjoy them on one night, then sit and listen to the same tracks and be quite disturbed on another. When you're dancing, it's as though the music removes the chill factor from the lyrics. Whatever it is, you want more. Split Ends have taken the best True Colours of the 60s and painted with an 80s brush. They strip their songs down so the melody comes through. They gave you instrumentals, energy, and a now famous Tin Fin ballad.
The big announcement, the Best Australian Album for 1980, Cold Chisel's East.
Picking up the award for Cold Chisel is Mr. Paul Turner, Managing Director of WEA Records.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you. From the band.
Famous debut albums, Australian Crawl, Boys Light Up.
Works back late at night. Hopes are up, but trousers down with the horse that's on the
Okay, that was Australian Crawl with The Boys Light Up, which of course is the title track of the album. And you may be interested to know that that album is near enough to now triple platinum, which is 150,000 copies, and that's great sales. And we're eagerly awaiting the next one, so goodness knows what they'll come up with. Our next guest would have to be the shyest person I know, but he will present the Best Producer Award. And actually, it's an award that he could be a strong contender for if it wasn't for the fact that he's a resident of England. The man I'm talking about is David Tickle, who produced the True Colours album for Split Enz, and whose professional involvement with Australia has been full of coincidences. When he was at school, he played in a band with the Vapors. But it wasn't until he was in Australia last year that he actually saw them again as they replaced the Enz, I've Got You at Number One, with Turning Japanese. But the reunion was more than amicable, because David has just completed the Vapors' new album. David has been involved with other bands in the past, Exile, The Knack, Blondie, and here's another coincidence, Miss Susie Quattro. Being a very shy guy, give him a very loud welcome. Would you please welcome to Australia, Mr. David Tickle.
Hello, Australia. I'm pleased to be here. I'm very proud to be able to present this award. The qualities that are needed to make a top producer are just too numerous to mention, but I was fortunate enough to work with the best record producer in the world, who's a homegrown Australian producer, Mike Chapman. And now for the new generation of top Australian record producers, Here are the nominees.
Cameron Allen, co-founder of Regular Records, shares the title of managing director with Martin Fabini. In 1980, Cameron, apart from in-house producing for Regular, produced the Numbers' self-titled debut album. Other outside work was The Sports' Stop the Baby Crying. Back in-house, Metal Is Anything, Espresso Bongo. And together with Ivor Davies, they produced some premeditated spontaneity on Ice House. Peter Dawkins, last year's best producer, had a varied year in 1980. He began the year with CBS and produced Outline. In August, he moved out and formed Giant Records. Some of the new talent he produced was Matt Finish and Mio 245. While still with CBS, My Sex and Their Space Race. Also in 1980, Sharon O'Neill, How Do You Talk to Boys? Mark Opitz began sound recording with the ABC in 1971. 1976 found him engineering for the Masters Vander & Young on The Angels, AC/DC, JPY and Flash in the Pan. He produced The Reels. Next came in-house producer for WEA. Cold Chisel attribute a lot of what's good on East to Mark Opitz.